The outbreak of World War II took many people by surprise, none more so than the men of the Kriegsmarine, the German Navy. They'd been promised that no war would come before 1942, and the sudden onset of hostilities found the German surface fleet woefully unprepared. Only the U-boat fleet was on anything like a wartime footing. The commander of the German U-boat fleet was Karl Dönitz, who had himself commanded a U-boat during World War I. Dönitz appreciated the possibilities which were inherent in U-boat warfare and was in a perfect position when it came to developing the new tactics which would shape the face of the battle for the Atlantic in World War II. In the wake of his overwhelming victory in France, Adolf Hitler hoped that Britain would make peace with Germany. But in June 1940, when Churchill refused to consider the German peace offers, Hitler threw one of his famous fits of pique. In a furious about turn, he ordered his strengthened U-boat fleet to make an all-out attack on British shipping, which he claimed would make the First World War U-boat campaign look like a sideshow. During the dark days of World War II, the men of Germany's U-boat fleet were the national heroes of their day, feted and adored by a grateful public. But their fame and adoration was hard won. Out of every four men who went to sea in the U-boats, three died in action, doomed to rest forever in an iron coffin. Of a total of 40,000 men who sailed in the U-boats, 5,000 were captured and 30,000 were killed in action, leaving only 5,000 to sail the boats home.
Hitler wanted to make peace because he felt that peace was inevitable. In simple terms, he felt that by June 1940, Germany quite clearly had won the Second World War, at least the war in Europe, up to that point, and that for Britain to continue fighting was nonsensical, as Britain quite clearly had no chance of winning. Unfortunately for Hitler, Britain did not quite agree with his analysis of the situation.
The sudden onset of war had left the giant merchant ships of the British Navy scattered across the oceans of the world. As the unescorted and defenceless ships dashed frantically for safe havens, they fell easy prey to U-boats and the auxiliary cruisers. Throughout the winter months, there was massive destruction of British shipping. In those first months of the war, to travel alone courted oblivion from beneath the waves. Despite the lessons from the First World War, the Navy was caught ill-prepared for the new submarine menace. The scattered seaways provided admirable scope for a U-boat. The British warships themselves were not immune from danger. In terms of sheer numbers, the Royal Navy had a massive amount of force available for the protection of British trade. Over 200 destroyers were at sea. Despite this, it's shocking to note that in the interwar years, the Admiralty had not carried out any operational analysis of how it had defeated the U-boat threat in the First World War. In fact, in 1937, the Admiralty declared that the development of its ASDIC sonar system had defeated any future U-boat threat. These boasts were to prove hopelessly inaccurate.
In light of its experience in the First World War, when it defeated a substantial German U-boat campaign, it would be expected that in 1939 the Royal Navy had in place the doctrine, ships and tactics for dealing with a resurgent German U-boat threat. However, the Navy paid no attention to convoy drills or rehearsing convoy procedures. The number of destroyers available for convoys was in fact quite small. they were allocated to the support of the battle fleets. The escorts that did exist had a very short range. This was fine whilst the battle remained in the North Sea. But when the Germans captured France in May-June 1940 and transferred their main U-boat bases to the French Atlantic coast, the Royal Navy faced the problem it would have to fight its opponents in the middle of the Atlantic. These created a major threat to Britain.
On September the 17th, the aircraft carrier Courageous was sunk, with a loss of over 500 men. It was a major blow to the Royal Navy. At this stage of the war, U-boats would sink the unarmed ships by fire from their deck guns. Although this was a slow and dangerous manoeuvre, there was often no choice. German torpedoes were plagued by development problems, which caused many to fail to explode.
In the First World War, torpedoes are detonated by percussion. They hit the target, a percussion cell was ignited, and the explosive detonated. This was all well and good, but sometimes the torpedo would run underneath the target and would therefore completely miss. Sometimes, if the torpedo struck the target at a glancing angle, there was not enough pressure on the percussion cap and the thing didn't detonate. So the Germans looked for a better kind of detonation device. And they came up with a magnetic detonator, in which the iron of the ship disturbed the magnetic field, or a magnetic field created by the torpedo. The beauty of this was you didn't actually have to hit the ship. If you were close enough, the proximity of the iron would disturb the magnetic field and the torpedo would go off. And if it was underneath the ship, this was even better, because the explosion would break the back of the ship and it would most certainly sink.
To combat the U-boat threat, hurried arrangements were made for British ships to travel in tight, escorted convoys, which allowed the unarmed ships to be guarded by destroyers and cruisers. In those early days, the system was makeshift and rather clumsy. No attempt was made to sort ships by their speed of travel, and the speed of the convoy was limited to that of the slowest ship. But it did significantly increase the chances of survival. For the Kriegsmarine, the main burden of the fight at sea was carried by the smaller craft, destroyers, torpedo boats and mine layers. In the early months of the war, the most successful weapon employed by the surface fleet was the mine. This early German newsreel shows the mines being manufactured in the factories, then shipped to the channel where they were laid in the sea lanes. Unnoticed by British observers, German destroyers clandestinely completed 11 mine-laying missions off the English coast, even venturing into the Thames estuary itself.
Britain's North Sea coastline is very long, and in darkness, it's virtually impossible to prevent submarines and aircraft making fast incursions and laying mines and getting away. Indeed, fast surface craft would be very difficult to prevent. So it was not too difficult for the Germans to lay mines along the British coastline.
The mines wreaked havoc amongst the Channel traffic. 67 ships, including two destroyers, were lost. These losses added to the steadily rising toll by the U-boats themselves and clearly showed the way ahead. The U-boats had won the political war, but could they also be relied on to win the real war? It seemed Hitler needed one more lesson to convince him. In the First World War, Britain had been saved from starvation by the development of the convoy system. Dönitz believed that this time he could overcome the British convoys by a combination of a bigger, faster, and more powerful submarine, allied to a new system of tactics which would become known as the Wolf Packs. From his headquarters at the French port of Lorient, Dönitz was able to control Wolfpack operations personally.
Dönitz would arrive in his headquarters at around 9 o'clock in the morning. There, his chief of staff, Captain Gott, would inform him of the latest positions, and up on the wall was an enormous map of the Atlantic. Here were the latest positions of German U-boats, indicated in blue, and Allied merchant convoys and ships, indicated in red. What then happened was that Dönitz received a series of detailed staff briefings from his intelligence officer in particular. At this point, the Germans were reading the British intelligence codes, and thus the Dönitz was able to form a clear picture of British movements and activities, and thus direct his wolf packs effectively against the British convoys.
The German wolf pack consisted of 15 to 20 U-boats. The tactics of the wolf pack dictated that initially, all of the submarines in a pack were to be spread out in a wide fan, covering the likely sea lanes leading to the British Isles. Operating alone, they would remain constantly vigilant as they waited for British convoys to pass by. If a single ship was spotted, it was permissible for the U-boat to launch an attack, and many lone merchantmen were sent to the bottom in the first few months of the war. But the main targets of the wolf packs were always the Atlantic convoys, so the crews of the British ships had to remain constantly on their guard. Once a convoy was sighted by a U-boat, it was an important part of the tactical doctrine that the submarine which spotted the convoy did not attack right away. Instead, it reported by coded radio signal using a highly sophisticated code which was encrypted on a specialized device known as the Enigma machine. These signals were sent directly to U-boat headquarters, giving the location, size, direction, and speed of the convoy. The lone submarine then shadowed the convoy, avoiding contact with the cruiser or destroyer escorts, but always keeping its prey in sight. Back at his headquarters, Dönitz radioed his orders to the other members of the wolf pack, who would then be instructed to close in for the attack. When enough submarines had been assembled near the convoy, usually on the first night after it was sighted, the signal was given for the attack to begin.
So, und wenn dann der Torpedo lief, dann wurde also die Stoppuhr angesetzt, ob er mit der Entfernung ungefähr, und wenn keine Detonation kam, oh Gott, dann war er vorbei. Ja, und knallte er oder was, so, dann war also irgendwie der Erfolg da. Ich kann also von meinem Boot sagen, Hurra geschrien wurde nicht, es wurde eher gesagt, oh Gott, die armen Däubel jetzt.
As soon as the U-boats had loosed their torpedoes, they dived further beneath the surface to escape the powerful explosive depth charges fired by the warships which escorted the convoy. The British destroyers posed a powerful threat to the U-boats. With their superior speed and agility, they could easily destroy any U-boat on the surface, and they proved to be tenacious in the chase for submerged U-boats, which could only travel very slowly underwater. If a convoy was well protected, the first attack would raise the alarm. In a moment, the hunter became the hunted, and the real trial for a submarine crew began. It was a battle for survival, to outwit the enemy above, in a tense and deadly game of hide and seek. A pattern of depth charges laid in a spread could either destroy the U-boat or cause damage enough to force it to the surface and into the waiting guns of the hunters.
Ja, eine Wasserbombenverfolgung als solche ging natürlich nicht nur an die Nerven, sondern ans Gemüt. Und das war schon schrecklich. Ja? Und wer behauptet, er hätte keine Angst gehabt, der lügt. Ja? Wasserbomben waren wirklich nervig. Also wenn es nahe kam, das können Sie sich gar nicht vorstellen, unter Wasserschall. Das ist ein so wahnsinniger Knall, den bringt eine Bombe an Land gar nicht mal. Und wenn dann also Beschädigung war, wupp, sprangen dann irgendwelche Ventile raus. Ja? Oder in der E-Maschine flogen die Schalter raus. Das Boot schüttelte sich. Dann war das also schon kritischer.
A damaged hull would be marked by a torrent of water, which would rapidly engulf the craft, taking it to the bottom. Often the craft was merely damaged to the extent that control was lost. But the hapless crew could do nothing but wait until it sank to a depth at which the massive pressure caused the hull to implode. The worst nightmare was to be trapped alive on the floor of the ocean, with the prospect of a slow death by asphyxiation. For the U-boat men, a depth charge attack was a nightmare world, which tested their stoic resolve. The psychological strain was immense as they waited for the shock waves of an exploding charge, not knowing if it would be a fatal blow. Despite the dangers, some of the bolder U-boat captains actually sought to draw off the escort ships, as this allowed the other members of the Wolfpack to close in for the kill unmolested. Night after night, the U-boats repeated this pattern of attack, running away to avoid the destroyers, and then returning once again to find a target. There were several reasons for preferring a night attack. Submerged, a U-boat travelled slowly. 8 knots was the maximum practical speed, and the duration of a dive was strictly limited. On the surface, a U-boat could maintain 16 knots, giving the boats a huge increased range. At that time, the convoy still relied mainly on visual observation to detect submarines. In the dark, the low profile of the U-boat was easily missed. The U-boat's much larger target was clearly silhouetted against any available light, particularly if another vessel had been set on fire. As they gained experience in their deadly trade, the Wolfpacks became bolder, and some adventurous captains even took to striking within the convoy itself, where the escorts dared not. The one area